Good morning, everyone. That was a great start. Great start. Well, welcome to New Hope. We praise God for the rain. It keeps on coming, and we love that. A little bit different than we've seen in the last few years. So if you are a visitor here today, welcome to New Hope. We appreciate you coming by. If you would, fill out a visitor thing and put it in the offering when it comes around. We really appreciate people that do that. We can reach out to you then and let you know what we do here at New Hope. So you have some idea of all the different things that are going on around here, not just here on Sunday morning, but the rest of the week as well. So Tim is with the team, the New Hope team. They just landed in Abidjan not long ago. I have it on good authority, which is Shelley, that they made it fine. So 24 hours of traveling. So they left San Francisco yesterday at around 9 o'clock and just got there this morning. So keep them in your prayers. Pastor Tim, that is Stephen Lee Childress and Lindsay Eccles. That's the New Hope team. But also keep in prayer the other 70 or so people that are out there doing what they're doing. It's not easy. And they're going to need all the prayers they can get to be the hands and feet of Jesus as they deal with all the construction and medical and water stuff that they do out there for the next 2 weeks. So later today, there are 21 days of fasting and prayer. Who's been participating in here in that? Who's made it 21 days? There's no shame in saying you haven't made it 21 days. Not a problem. Even if you didn't, and even if you haven't been fasting and praying, 5 p.m. this evening or later this afternoon at Fresno Pacific University, there'll be a worship and general prayer time with a group of churches from the local area coming together for that, which will be a lot of fun. I'll be there a little bit before 5, so come on over. We'll get a group of New Hope people, and we'll worship with local churches in the area to celebrate the end of the 21 days of fasting and prayer. Young adults, we have on February 21st, that is 25 through 40, or if you're married to someone between 25 and 40. So we're having an event on the 21st here at New Hope, 5 p.m., just come and hear Tim and I talk about what we have, some ideas that we have, some thoughts, what's on our heart for that age group in this church, which is really the future of New Hope, along with the kids associated with that age group. So just come and listen, participate. We'll be looking for feedback from you as well, so I think it'll be a very useful session, especially if you've got something on your mind or on your heart that you want to share with us. On March 12th, Men's R3 Conference. R3, it's in the bulletin, but it stands for Revive, Restore, and Relaunch. This will be a full-day men's conference at New Covenant Church, just down on Cedar and Knees. It should be a really good conference. There's breakout sessions, a lot of different subjects to cover. It'd be really good to get a good group of men from New Hope to go to that so that we can create this core group that we're looking for in the men's ministry. It's $48, kind of steep for a day. So if you find that $48 is just a little bit too much for you, come see me and we'll work something out. But it'll be a really good day of learning and prayer and different sessions to learn about ministries. I think we have a clipboard for grief share and go around. So we're gonna pass a clipboard around for grief share. There's two sessions starting for grief share. This month. One starts on the, where is it? Lost it now. 16th. So the Tuesday and a Wednesday. There's two sessions running, one on a Tuesday, one on a Wednesday. So 16th and 17th, those two sessions start for grief share. Not this Tuesday, but next Tuesday is a seniors luncheon, so 55 plus. Be thinking about that. Put it on your calendar to attend on the 9th of February. And we are still looking for Sunday school teachers, specifically for 5th and 6th. A lot of people have responded, which has been awesome for Sunday school teachers, for the little kids. But the older kids need teachers too. And actually, that's a really, really good age group to teach. Don't be afraid of them. They might ask questions. They ask good questions, but they're not difficult questions. They're the sort of questions where you think, these kids are really thinking, and that's what you want. And you don't have to know all the answers. I certainly didn't when I started teaching that age group. But it's very rewarding, and it's a really good age to be teaching. And it's a very important age group because they're about to go up into junior high, and sometimes they start drifting off. So So it's a really good age group to be teaching at that point. So we need teachers. Also, substitute teachers. If you just want to fill in every now and then, if somebody's off sick or somebody's on vacation, just let Jennifer know, and we can set you up as a substitute teacher, which is really, really useful to have. Save the date for Women's Luncheon, February 27th. I think Fawn is going to talk about it more next week. But put that on your calendar for the Women's Luncheon, February 27th. Tickets go on sale next week. So, but Fawn will tell you more about it next week, or you can just ask her about it when you see her. So congratulations to the Christensen family on the birth of their baby this week. So Amanda and Cameron had their baby early hours of Monday morning. So congratulations to them and prayers. Yeah. So keep in your prayers the Christensen and Panos families for the addition of their new little one. We have a few prayer requests today. The Cipolla family. Tim has been emailing about the Cipolla family, and there's been a lot of discussion here. I think he talked about it last week. So these are friends and neighbors of Doreen, of Tanji Lewandowski. Doreen Cipolla was pregnant, and her and her husband were expecting a baby. It was almost full term. She had a stroke and went into a coma. They did emergency C-section, and the baby was taken. Unfortunately, the baby did not survive. And unfortunately, this week, Doreen also passed away. So prayers to that family, but also, you know, to Tanji as well. But she's part of the family of God that's surrounding this family right now. And they have a lot of people doing that. They go to Northside, so it's, you know, they have strong faith around them, and that's very, very important at this time. So just pray for them, but also the people around them that are supporting them. Bob Stokel, many of you know him. On Friday, we heard that he was doing yard work, had a heart attack. Fortunately, his wife Jamie was there. They managed to get him to a hospital fairly quickly, despite living not too close. But so he got to hospital within a good time. They did surgery and put in a stent, so he is going home today. So prayers for him, if you would. Yeah, that's good news. You know, that's God's timing. Jamie was there. You know, if she hadn't been, who knows what would have happened. But that definitely is God's timing. Carol Padilla, her family, the death of her son, we pray for them. Pray for comfort during this time. The service for that is here on February 6th. That's this Saturday. Shirley Passarella had foot surgery, and Daryl Croker had shoulder surgery, so we just pray for a rapid recovery for them. And they're all part of our regular attenders. So Chris is going to give us a quick outline on the Mexico mission trip now.
Thanks, Mark. How's everybody doing today? Awesome, awesome. Well, I'm Pastor Chris. I'm the youth pastor here, and I'm so excited that we are getting ready to go to Mexico this year. I got to share this in first service, and there's like just years and years of pictures on the one wall of us going, of this church going down and supporting Mexico and all the different outreaches that we've done down there, and we get to build on the legacy that you guys and our church and Robert and his team and people before him have built. So I'm really excited. This is my first year going with you guys, with us. I've been before, and it was a life-changing experience. And I just wanted to give you guys a couple of information things and then a couple of ways you can support us as we go. We're looking at taking hopefully 50 students down, 50 people down. It's going to be awesome. We're going down and teaming with Calvary Chapel Rosarito. So we're going down there, and I'm so excited because we are year one. We're one of the founding churches we're not the founding church, but we're like the next one in on a building project where we're going to build an orphanage for these people. So for this year, we're actually building like a double house or two houses or something right around there, whatever works out the best. And so we're building a house for the people to stay in who are going to work in the orphanage. And then next year, we're going to build the orphanage. And if it takes another year, we'll tack on another year, and then at the end, we're going to build some more facilities. So we're looking at a 3 or 4 year project, so we're going to get to see the same people over and over. We're going to interact with the same people over and over, and I think it's just going to be a phenomenal way, especially for our students who are going to really just see what God's doing outside of Clovis. Mission trips were huge for me growing up. And I remember going down to Mexico so many times and just being blown away by what God does. And traveling outside of the U.S., even though it's kind of, you know, attached. Traveling outside the U.S. Really kind of opens your eyes to a broader worldview. And so I'm excited that we get to partner and do this. There are costs associated with going down. And so that's the other bit that we want to talk about today. Normally it takes us $25,000 to $30,000 to go down. And that is room and board, food for everybody. That's our project. That's donations. That's stuff we give to them. It's an awesome trip. And to see God move is really cool. So the number one way you can support us, and I would ask that everybody would do this, is by your prayers. I feel so blessed that I landed in such a big praying church. So be praying for our team. Be praying for our students. Today's the first day of our Mexico training. Students, if you're in here, it's the first day of your Mexico training. Today's the first day. So I'm super excited. We're going to meet in there at 1, and we're going to start our training and do a bunch of that stuff. So if at 1 today, if you think about us, be praying for us. These students see each other kind of throughout the week at school, but they're coming together as a missions team for the first time, and we're having different people and friends coming in. The dynamics can be different in this kind of a situation. So please be praying for us. That would be awesome. The next way would be to go to Mexico with us. I've had a couple people be like, oh, well, once I retire or once I get a little bit older or once this, I dare you to go. Talk to me. Talk to Teddy back there. Talk to one of us. Talk to Brittany. Ask questions. We would love to talk to you about it. I dare you to go. It would be awesome. The third way is by giving financially. We have a couple of opportunities to do this. And funny story, when I was interviewing for this church, I've been here 6 months now. And when I was interviewing, I was doing some research. And so I popped online. And I was like, oh, cool. They do missions trips. Awesome. And then I popped online to see the thing that you guys call that I am so excited to experience this year, the pie auction. Right? So I kicked on, and this thing is like amazing, right? And it shows all of the things, and to see how much you guys support and love teenagers and want to see teens' lives changed blows me away. So the pie auction's coming up March 6th. More information will be in your bulletin about that. So that's one way you can support. So be saving up for that. It's going to be phenomenal this year. The second way you can do, and I'm really excited about this because I'm all about connections and connecting people. The second way that we earn money by going is every student has to fill out sponsorship letters. Okay, they have a required amount that they have to send out. And I'm sure some of you guys have gotten those sponsorship letters, maybe 10 or 12 of them. We're going to work on that this year. If you want 10 or 12, cool. I'll tell you how to ask for 10 or 12 sponsorship letters. That's cool too. But we want to create an opportunity for you to connect with a student. We want to create an opportunity where you can maybe meet a student you've never met before and really help impact their lives. And so if you would like to sponsor a student, whether it's $5 or $50 or whatever you want to give, if you would like to sponsor a student to help them get down to Mexico to have God have a life-changing experience, I would ask you to do one thing today, is grab your Connect card in the pew in front of you, okay? You got to fill out some information so I know how, so I can get the student to actually get a hold of you, okay? So put your address and phone number and all that. But if you would like to receive a letter from a student, if you would like to sponsor a student this year, grab the Connect card. On the back, there's a how may we serve you, pray for, prayer request, and comment, okay? There's this other area right here. Say, I would like to sponsor a student, or Mexico donations, or Mexico sponsorship, okay? Write that on the back of the card and just simply put that in the offering plate, and it'll get to me. And then a student will be able to send you a letter, and really, you will be able to impact that student. With that letter, you're going to get a picture, and you're going to be able to pray for those students. You're going to be able to meet those students. We're setting up a meet and greet. So if you actually sponsor a student, the other cool thing is on February 21st, during the two services, so this service and the next service, we'll be in the bridge, and you can sponsor a student. When you sponsor your student, you can actually go and meet your student. We're going to have dessert and breakfast. Yes, dessert and breakfast, over in the bridge. And you can actually meet your student. I think that's a really cool way to connect. And so if you're interested in sponsoring a student this year, again, it doesn't matter how much money you give, okay? It's that you're connecting with your student. That's another way that you can do that. So grab a Connect card in the pew in front of you. On the back, fill out some information on the back. Put Mexico donation. If you have sponsored a student for the last 10 years... Wait, maybe not 10. If you sponsor a student for 10 years, you need to talk to me. That's not good. That wouldn't be good. You'll get it. If you sponsor a student for the last 4 years or so and you want to sponsor that student again, just write on the card, say, I want to sponsor so-and-so. Boom, and just put their name, and then I will connect you with that student. So really, we want to create ways where you can get connections with our students. They're going to go down. They're going to have a phenomenal time. They're going to have a life-changing experience. I know if you talk to anybody who's gone, they will just brag and brag and brag about how God has changed their lives in Mexico. So please be praying for us. If you're interested in donating, just fill out a Connect card, and that'll get to me. If you want more information, put it on the Connect card. Hey, I'd like more Mexico information. I'll get that to you as well. Let's pray, and we'll have the worship team come back up. God, I love you. God, I praise you. God, I thank you that we have an opportunity to seek your face this morning. God, is there a hurt and pain, and is there suffering out there, God, I just ask that you truly move in these people's lives. God, you know these prayer requests. You've heard these prayer requests. God, I ask for your will in these prayer requests. God, I ask for your sufficiency, that you make that enough for these people who are suffering and who need you, God. And I ask for a special prayer for the unsung prayer requests. God, people here today who need a special touch from you. God, I ask that you start to open our hearts. God, I ask that you start to open our minds and our ears to what you have to say to us today. God, I love you and I praise you. Amen. Can we
ask this thing on? Not yet. Test, test, test. Are we good to go? Can you guys hear me? Okay, I can't hear me. That's okay. Not in the back. Need a little more juice in the back, I guess. Find my place. We're going to be in Psalms today, as we have been for the last several weeks. I'm secretly excited about us getting together and investigating the book of Psalms. I think it's come at a perfect time in my life, as I feel I am just on the past the hill and down toward the other side of depression. And so I feel like I'm coming out of that, and God's not done with me yet, but Psalms are a great place to go for encouragement, for comfort, and to examine a side of us that I think our culture says is wrong in some ways. In some ways, I think that our culture tells us that it's wrong to be emotional, but I'm getting a little bit ahead of myself. I'd like to begin by sharing a poem that I committed to memory when I was just a wee little lad knee-high to a grasshopper. Shel Silverstein, do you remember him? Yeah, wrote several large books of poetry, Where the Sidewalk Ends, A Light in the Attic, or two that come to mind right away. And as I think about the Psalms that we're in, I think of them as poetry. I know they're hymns and I know they're songs, but I think the lyrics of songs are poetry as well. And I can't help but think about Shel Silverstein when I think of poetry. And so here it is. It's a true story. That's the title of it. So this morning, I jumped onto my horse and I went out for a ride when some wild outlaws chased me and they shot me in the side. So I crawled into a wildcat's cave so that I could hide. But some pirates found me hiding there. And soon they had me tied to a pole and they built a fire under me. I almost cried, but a mermaid came and cut me loose and begged to be my bride. So I said, I'll come back Wednesday, but I must admit I lied. Instead, I ran into a jungle swamp. But I forgot my guide and I fell into some quicksand where I met a water snake named Clyde. And an eagle came and swooped me up and through the air we flied. And he dropped me in a boiling lake 1,000 miles wide. And you'll never guess what I did then. I died. So that's Shel Silverstein's true story, as he puts it. And gosh, there's so many things that art and poetry, I think, do for us. And I'd like to get into that with your permission a little bit this morning. You'll find that I'm a little bit different. I'm not, obviously, Pastor Tim. One of us is much better looking. I didn't say which one. And one of us is far more wise and eloquent. And as I think about Pastor Tim and this journey that he's taken to Africa, I remember that he is one of the strongest men in his faith that I've ever known. And I'm thankful for all his faults that he has been a pillar for me growing up to see what strength really looks like in faith. And I think about when I think about Africa, I can't help but think about lions. I don't know, my brain's just kind of wired that way. And then that reminds me of Proverbs 3:5-6, which says, be self-controlled and alert. The enemy, your devil, prowls around like a roaring lion searching for those he may devour. And I feel like Tim, along with the others that have gone with him, are in Africa now fighting lions. And they need our prayer. And not fighting lions of the physical sort, of course, but the supernatural, the things of principality that they fight. And we're so lucky to have them doing that here with us. And Africa is lucky now to have them there with their strength. But I think also in that verse, Proverbs, where it says, be self-controlled. Be self-controlled and alert. Why? Because there's this enemy, the devil, who's prowling around looking for someone to devour. And it makes me think, well, what happens if I'm not self-controlled, if I'm not alert? Well, then perchance I would be devoured by Satan himself. And that is an incredibly scary thought, is it not? But what does it mean to be self-controlled? As I think about poetry and I reflect on the Psalms, there's a lot of it that doesn't look very controlled to me. In fact, a lot of it seems kind of chaotic and emotional. As a church, we've been studying these Psalms, about which I'm secretly thrilled. The Psalms, I believe, for us, offer a chance to look within and show us how to be honest with ourselves and what we find therein. Today, we dive into Psalms 13, one of the most profoundly lamenting pieces of poetry of all the passages. But before that, I would like, with your permission, for us to engage in a little bit of chatter. I'm going to ask you some questions, and I want you to remember that there's no wrong answers, only people contemplating matters of poetry and verse. Can we do that today? Can we treat this less like a sermon and more like a conversation? Because I'm different than maybe some speakers that you've heard, than a lot of speakers that I've heard. And I think that if we're going to unpack a lamenting poem today, it's going to require a little bit more of us. We're going to have to exercise a part of us that we're not used to exercising. So I'll ask questions, and I want you to know that I'm perfectly comfortable in awkwardness. In fact, I thrive in awkwardness. One of the things I like to do in social settings, and you might practice this if you're a little like I am, you can just stand next to somebody. You know that every person is entitled by law of 18 inches of space? Did you know that? It's a law because it's intuitive to us. There is a mark somewhere between 18 and 19 inches that we don't want somebody to cross. And when they do, it feels awkward unless we're really close to that person. So if you try this at a party, just go stand up next to a person. Just get inside their 18 inches and just stand there. Just don't say anything. I mean, you could look at them and smile if you really want to make it awkward. You can add these other little things. You can look them right in the eyeballs. People aren't used to that. Do you recognize that when you're talking to somebody, a lot of times you're looking at their lips because you want to hear and see the sounds that are coming from them, and you want to be able to receive that and articulate back, and you're forming responses before they're even done. But if you look them in the eyeballs, just watch them quiver. That's fun. And if you want to add a little more to that, just put your feet together like this, because for whatever reason, if you put your feet together and your arms to your side and then just don't clench up, but just stand like this. This is an awkward just way to be. So just stand next to that person and be awkward. I spent too much time here, but I want you to let you know that if you choose not to, and it's your choice by right, to not respond, I'm going to ask you questions and you can say, forget you, guy, I'm going to sleep. And you'll be just like my kids at that point. But you can decide not to respond. But I want you to know in advance, if you choose not to respond, then I'm comfortable with that. We'll just sit in that awkward silence for as long as it takes. We'll listen to the birds chirp, or I might even just get in your 18 inches and start singing you a lullaby or something. So, all right, here we go. All right, considering song and poetry or any form of art, can you remember a time, any time in your life when you were emotionally moved by song, verse, poetry, where it affected you at a deep level, be it happy and jubilant, or be it sad and sorrowful? Can you remember, can you think of a verse, a line, a sonnet, a poem that did that for you? I'm sure you can. So what was it? Yes. Overwhelmed. Amen. Yes. Grandma. Yes. Yes. Say again?
Love it.
Love it.
Love every journey you go through.
Love every journey you go through. What else? A song or a poem that struck a nerve? A hymn or a verse?
Did you say a song or a song?
Yes. Amen. And forgive my ignorance, is that a classical piece? Is it jazz? Okay, cannons. When I hear cannons, I just think cannonballs, and that shows my ignorance right there. Okay, I'll let you off the hook a little bit on that one, but there'll be more questions. Considering song poetry, I'll share this with you. In high school, I read a poem, "Raisin in the Sun." You guys remember that one? Is it called "Raisin in the Sun" or is it called something else? Yeah, "Raisin in the Sun." Yeah. It goes like this. Okay, what happens to a dream deferred? Does it dry up like a raisin in the sun, or fester like a sore and then run? Does it stink like rotten meat, or crust and sugar over like a syrupy sweet? Maybe it just sags like a heavy load, or does it explode? And I'll tell you that when I read that in high school, that poem made literally nothing to me. I couldn't care less. But as you get older and you have these dreams, and some of which you chase and fail, and some of which you never had the courage to chase at all, or just matters of life getting in the way, and I think about the dream deferred, and does it dry up like a raisin in the sun? Does it just disappear? And the things of poetry mean more to me today than they ever have. I'm not going to tell you that God has put me through the last several years through an emotional grinder, but I will tell you that He has certainly allowed it. I feel now like, praise God, I'm well over the hump of depression, of despondency. And this odd, interesting thing has happened. Something that I couldn't quite see when I was there in the pits of my own self-loathing, self-despair. It's an odd thing to try to explain. It's something, this thing that's happened to me that I've gained actually through depression. It's like trying to tell somebody what salt tastes like. Can you tell me what salt tastes like? Yeah, it's salty, right? And so somebody who's not been through it can't really relate, but I suspect that many and most of you can. I feel like I see colors now that weren't there before. Like, they say that men only see 8 colors anyway, so maybe I see 9 now. I've added periwinkle, perhaps, I don't know. But things that I used to just glance over, and I used to think, honestly, I thought that I could appreciate art as much as anyone. But I think what I was really doing was appreciating the effort that went into the piece. If there was a talented musician or an intricate piece of an intricate painting or something to that effect, I feel like I could appreciate what the artist put into it. You understand? But the piece itself didn't really move me. I could hear songs all day long, and if they weren't about Jesus, then they didn't have any hope of turning or churning anything in here. And that's all changed now. I lived down on Ashland. I'm sorry, not anymore. I used to live on Ashland on 168 and Academy. And so, pretty much from anywhere I am during the day, I have to drive east to get home. And there was a day not too long ago that it had just been raining. And it wasn't raining anymore, but there was a blanket of clouds still overhead. Are you with me? So there I am heading east on 168. The sun was setting in the west. It gotten to the point where it had gotten below this blanket of clouds. And so you had this contrast of like, it's not raining, but it's still cloudy. It's sunny, but there's all these shadows, and that sun drew straight across the horizon to the other side, and it bounced off of the Sierra Nevadas out there, just the tips, and there was this snow on some of those tips. And I got to tell you, I might be losing my mind, but I had to stop. This never would have happened to me before. I had to stop. I pulled off of the freeway, and I opened my door, and there's these cars zoom, zoom, rushing by. I got on top of my truck, stood on the truck rack, and I was trying to get my hands in that sun that was coming from the west. I just wanted to take it in. It was so majestic, so beautiful. And I closed my eyes for a moment, and I said, "Thank you, Jesus." I'd seen something. I was able to experience something on an emotional level that I wasn't able to before. What is it, do you think? What is it about art that is meaningful? What makes art meaningful, do you think? What it does to you? What does it do to us? It affects you? It's personal. Doesn't it touch a piece of us? Doesn't it trigger a memory or an emotion? I like what Rachel Miller, I found this quote online. She's I don't want to call her a nobody, she's a somebody. She caught my attention, but she's a teacher off in some other state. And she says, the fact that art means something different to everyone is the beauty of art. I think I'd rather like that. If it's true that If it's true that art touches different people in different ways, what does that say about us? Is that not evidence that there's more to man than flesh and bone? Doesn't that say that there's something in here that gets, quote, touched that is not part of my biology? I feel that it's profound evidence that there's something more to us, this thing that is me, that keeps on living when my body dies. That's the piece that gets touched by art. All right, I'm really going to incriminate myself now. I was watching a movie, and I had just eaten a bowl of ice cream or cereal, I don't remember which, probably cereal. My son and I, we tend to eat cereal nearly after every dinner meal. I don't know why. It's our thing. But I was laying there on the couch alone, and I was watching this movie, and I don't even remember what Medicine Man or something like that. So I was done with my cereal, and I had the spoon in my hand, and I was kind of fidgeting with it. And then I noticed how, like, I would expect metal to be cold, but this metal was warm, and it was smooth, and I was just, like, caressing it. And then I didn't realize I was doing it until I held it up to the television set, and I was trying to make the tip of the spoon touch one corner and the handle of the tip touch the other corner. And then when I realized what I was doing, my little pinky was up and everything. And I threw the spoon down. I'm thinking, oh, man, you're losing it, dude. I think you're gay. Like, I was, and then I realized, like, well, shoot, that I shouldn't be. I shouldn't let that affect me so much. So I picked the spoon back up, and nobody was around, and I recommitted to caressing my little spoon. And I guess I just like spooning, but what I'm trying to get at is that, like, there's something in this thing that's changing. And I think it's more than just biology. I think it's more than just body. I think that mankind, you and I, we have thought, don't we? We have cognition. That's our mind. We have sociology. We have people, environment. We have these other influencers in our lives. We have will. That's our intention, our desire, and our action. And we have emotion, our feelings, our sentiment, our passion. So isn't it emotion? Isn't it the emotional part of us that gets triggered when we behold a piece of art? If we get moved by a poem or a verse, a sonnet, isn't that the emotional component of man that's being influenced at that moment? So where do emotions originate? I mean, in other words, why do we have emotions? Where did they come from, do you think? From God? I heard something back here. Everything comes from God. From the soul, from the heart. A lot of people would agree with you. A lot of people would say that, yes, we have emotions because God created that within us. Some people, though, would say that emotions are a result of the fall, that they're part of chaos, and they came along with cancer and hurricanes. Some people will say that emotion came by means of evolution, that it was a way to maintain and protect the pack. I happen to believe the first. I believe that we are born under a very creative God, and out of that creation, we were given emotion. And I believe that because as I read through the scriptures, I see times where God was absolutely angry. I mean, we call it a righteous indignation, but he was wrathful, was he not? Angry. I see other times where he was filled with compassion and sorrow and pity for us. I see times where God himself was jealous. And other times where he was pleased. Still more times where he was displeased. And I see that we have an emotional God. This God of love. I was driving down where Abbey meets Blackstone. Have you been there? Where Blackstone splits off into two roads. And if you ever go down there, there's some really interesting stores you might want to take a look at. But that's not the one I'm talking about. The one I want to talk about is across the street to the east of Abbey. And there's this great gray building there, about three stories tall. And on the side of that building, facing the north, I think, if you have to face north to look at it. Have you seen it? No, it's not a mini storage. But on the side of this building is a piece of stencil art that's been painted. And it's just a simple black and white depiction of Einstein. And he's standing there in kind of loose clothing, and he's holding a sign. And on that sign, it says, "Love is the answer." That little piece of graffiti art also stopped me in my tracks. I made a U-turn to go and look at it. I was having a bad day, and I looked up at that sign. I actually took a picture of it with my phone, and I thought, is love the answer? Is it? I think it must be, because in the book of 1 John talks about how God is love. And I'm going to mess with some of y'all's theology a little bit right now. And it's okay. You and I can disagree. We don't have to agree on this point. This point is debated among Christians, and one of these days, we thinking differently will both be in heaven together, and one of us will laugh at the other who was wrong. Okay, but I'm not saying it's necessarily mean. But I'll say this: I don't think that we were created to worship. We hear that a lot in the church, don't we, that we're created to worship? But I don't think it's true. I think that worship is the natural result of how we were created. But the why we were created, I believe, lies in the character of God, who is love. You think about it. If God, a loving God, this creator, this creative entity, if that's who he is, then how could he not create? To not create would be acting outside of his character. If he's creative, he doesn't create, it'd be outside of his character. If he looked down on me and says, "Robert, if I create you, you will turn against me. You will cause me sorrow in my life. And in fact, you are going to mess up so bad, Robert Hutchinson III, that I'm going to have to send my son, whom I love and adore, who's done nothing wrong, to die for your ignorant, selfish ways. And so if I do this, Robert, if I create you, I'm going to go through all of this pain. Therefore, I'm not going to create you." Does that sound like love? But a loving God, knowing all of that would happen in advance, created you and I anyway, knowing the sacrifices that he was going to make. Why? Because that's what a parent does. That's what an artist does. That's what a creator does. That's what love does. It creates and nurtures. And since we were created, I believe we are created with emotions so that we can be like God in his image, right? Not in his image in the sense that God's saying like, "Oh, I'm super amazing and full of vanity, and I want to create little mini-me's that kind of look like me but will never be good enough." No. I want to create beings with free will and choice and have the emotional ability, the emotional prowess to be able to meet me where I am, to choose me, to love me, and to love each other. So if it's true that we have emotions and God created them, why do people tend to downplay emotions, do you think? I mean, first off, do you agree with that? Do you think that people in American culture especially, do you think that we downplay emotions? Men, do you feel that it's appropriate to cry? I mean, really? I mean, we're told that it is, right? We're told that, hey, go ahead and cry. It's okay. You're a human being, blah, 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 all that stuff. But is that what we experience in our culture? When we're at our buddy's house and we rack our thumb on a hammer, right? And maybe we're just like 12 when that happens. And we feel like crying, but we don't. Why? Why is that? When there is a loss in the family, when a dog dies maybe, and everybody in the home is broken up and crying, do you feel like you're allowed to, or do you feel like you have to be the strong one? I feel like often emotions are downplayed in our culture. I think it happens in a microculture where you have friends relating to one another, and we downplay emotion, and we don't even realize it, but we just feel uncomfortable. Right? Somebody gets up in our 18 inches of space and they're crying and some of that snot and blood might get on us and we get uncomfortable. We start feeling what they're feeling and that makes us vulnerable. And so what do? We try to fix it, don't we? We try to fix it. We try to come up with some solution that makes all those feelings go away, not even realizing that the whole reason we're doing it is so that we don't have to feel it too. I think that emotions are often unreliable. My grandmother told me this when I was young. She quoted a verse in Jeremiah. I didn't know it was in Jeremiah until last night when I looked it up, but it's Jeremiah 17:9, and she quote the verse that our hearts are wicked to the core. Our hearts are wicked to the core. That was a tough verse to swallow when, you know, you're in your early teens. But I came to believe it because there's so many things in life, like when I wanted to marry Amy Reese. Oh my God, thank God. Thank you for unanswered prayers. Like, holy moly, I could have been in much bigger trouble than I am today. But there's so many things that my heart wanted and God didn't give me. And I'm glad because my heart was lying to me. So we think that emotions, we come to find that emotions are unreliable. I mean, haven't many tragedies over the history of mankind happened as a result of passionate what they thought was virtue? And then we hear things in the church like that self-controlled and alert bit, right? Be self-controlled. When we are in an emotional state, do we feel like we're in control? Do you? I don't. I feel out of control. I feel chaotic. I feel like sometimes I don't know which end is up. But you know that verse in Jeremiah 17? It goes on to say, who can temper this heart? Jeremiah is crying out. Who can know this wicked heart? And then God actually responds in verse 10. He says, I can. I can search your heart and know you. And that means a little something different to me because I don't just have to choke my emotions down because my heart is wicked. I can let them out to God, to be bare before God and let Him see everything that's going on there, the good, the bad, and the ugly. And He says, I know what to do with that. So here's the big question. Are emotions wrong? No? No. Are you sure? Okay, because I'm going to test it. Ready? So, you wouldn't say to a child who just dropped her ice cream cone, stop crying. Right? Perhaps somebody in the first service said, yes. And it reminded me of that quote. Did I already give you that quote about the trees? Okay, three services, so sometimes you forget. How's it go? If trees could scream, would we be so cavalier about cutting them down? And the answer, maybe, if they screamed all the time for no good reason. Right? Bye. I'll miss you. Oh my gosh. That's my daughter. She's like, I heard this before. Let's get out of here. I'm hungry. I don't blame her. Doggone it. All right. Where was I? Oh, okay. More questions. Would you tell the son of a battered woman that he shouldn't be angry? And surely you wouldn't tell a lotto winner to stop dancing. Okay, good. But those are kind of easy. Let's dig in a little deeper. What if the emotion was inappropriate or the emotion was the result of a poor decision? What of laughing at a funeral? Yeah, that bare naked lady sings a song. I'm the kind of guy who laughs at a funeral. You guys have no idea what I'm talking. I'm pretty sure I'm going to hell for having listened to that. Just teasing. Laughing at a funeral. What about indifference to injustice? Something terrible is happened in your field of view and the people around you just don't care. Ever been around a crying drunk? How did that make you feel? What about a man who's depressed after leaving his kids? I mean, it's his fault he left. Are those emotions okay? So when do you think emotion is wrong? When it causes you to hurt somebody else? I'll buy into that. Yeah. So if emotion doesn't cause you to act, what then? I don't feel like the emotion itself is innately wrong. Like ever. I think it's evidence that we're a human being. It's evidence of our humanity. However, we both express and, like you said, cause incredible pain if we rely on emotions alone. Remember, there is more to man, to you and I, than just a single component. We're not just emotional beings, and we're not just intellectual beings. Psalm 13. This is how it reads. Will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and every day have sorrow in my heart? How long will my enemy triumph over me? Look on me and answer, O Lord my God. Give light unto my eyes, or I will sleep in death. My enemy will say, I have overcome him, and my foes will rejoice when I fall. But I trust in your unfailing love. My heart rejoices in your salvation, and I will sing to the Lord, for he has been good to me. David said so many times, how long, how long, how long? And I feel like David was in the place of despondency, of depression. I had a friend, I was 20 years old when I knew him. His name was Jim Kowalski. And Jim was a little bit older than me, and I used to do work over at his house. He had been married and divorced. His wife left him, and he was remarried by the time I knew him. And I would go over there and do little things like fixing the plumbing and tweaking on his backyard gate and things like that. Jim's kids were grown and left the house, and he didn't get to talk to them much anymore, and the wife he was living with didn't want him. One morning, I got a call that Jim had shot himself in his bed. And I think, what is it? What is it, you guys, that brings us to that place of no return? I mean, how does a person like Jim get to that place? He was a kind individual, very generous. He was always giving me stuff. I don't know why he had so many gloves, but he just gave me gloves all the time. But how does a person get so depressed, so despondent, and cross that line where there is no return? I feel like David was in some of that. I mean, it's normal to feel grief after a significant loss, right? Grief is the painful process of adjusting to a new set of circumstances. As acceptance takes place, grief subsides and gives way to joy. However, sometimes grief can lead to hopelessness. This occurs when acceptance is rejected. Can I say that again? Hopelessness occurs when acceptance is rejected, when things change in our life and we just cannot bring ourselves to accept those changes. Hopelessness occurs. And this is when despondency and depression take over. And we need only read Psalm 13 once before picking up on David's despondency, right? He's like a lonely friend dropping hints on Facebook. He feels down and lost and forgotten. I think it's fair to say that David, in his despair, he feels miserable. And no one knows for certain. The background of many psalms is a mystery. Nevertheless, his words resonate with our own painful feelings. And I wonder if you've come here today with pain in your heart. I think about David's background before he got to this moment. And I remember that David started out as a little shepherd boy. And he would spend much time off in the plains tending to his sheep. And that would have given him a lot of time to think and wonder and wrestle through thoughts. And I'm sure he would have thought about his brothers at home who disliked him. And he certainly wasn't the go-to guy to slay Goliath, but that's what happened. And when he did, the community around him, if you can imagine all of Clovis and Fresno and the surrounding areas writing songs about this victory that you won, this one time in the span of your life that you accidentally did something right and you were right there in the will of God and something brilliant happened and suddenly everybody thought you were amazing. And this happened to David. And he drew the attention away from Saul, who was the king at the time. And Saul became very jealous. In fact, so jealous of these songs that people were lifting up and praising David for his feats of glory, that in his jealousy, he wanted to kill David and actually sent people. He himself went to kill David, caused David to have to run off and hide in caves, sometimes not knowing if he would be dead the next morning or if he would have food that night to eat. And you would think that that's enough turmoil enough to cause despondency. But I think the worst part of it all is that David loved Saul. David loved his king. He was taught to do that. And he was a good boy, and so he did. But his king hated him in return. Some of us have been, or maybe are in that place where we love someone who does not return it. Who cannot return it. Who will not return it. And in fact, sometimes that space grows and the person actually comes to hate us. And that's a terrible, horrible place for a person to live. And David says, "How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me?" What did David want more than anything? I think he wanted to be seen. He wanted to be heard. He wanted to be understood. He wanted God to hear his cry, and he wanted to see God's face. He wanted to be in God's presence. He wanted to commune and communicate with God. So many of us walk this earth feeling misunderstood, like nobody gets it. And we cry out sometimes in the night alone when it's okay and no one will see us. And we look up to God and we ask him to understand, feeling like there is no response. "How long must I wrestle with my thoughts?" David says. "Day after day I have sorrow in my heart. Will my enemy ever triumph over me? Will you allow this, God?" What enemy is David talking about? He could have been talking about Saul, right? He could have been talking about a number of people who were after him to kill him. But he doesn't mention those people at all. What does he mention instead? "How long must I wrestle with my thoughts and have sorrow in my heart? My enemy is winning, God. As I cry out to you, and Jesus, as you ignore me, my thoughts are racing in this circular pattern of unending, seems like logic, but never brings me anywhere. I stay up at night, not finding an answer. And God, I cry out to you, and you do not answer me. How long will that continue?" David wasn't just worried about the moment he was in. He was worried that those moments that had been stacked up one against the other that brought him to the place he was in were going to continue indefinitely. And he cried out to God, "I can get out of this. Lord, I know how you can save me, but you don't seem to do it. And I wonder, God, how long will it take? And will I make it as long as you need it to be?" David was plagued by the thoughts in his mind and the sorrow in his heart. And it seems to me that those were David's enemy. Do you realize that you talk to yourself? Every person does. Every person does. Some of you talk to yourselves in a way that you would never talk to a friend. Shame on you for that. What does David think will happen to him if God does not answer? He says that I will sleep in death. If God takes too long to respond, God will find him dead. His enemies will overcome him and laugh when he fails. And that's David's picture. If God, I've been crying out to you for a long time, and if you don't respond soon, guess what's going to happen? You're going to find me dead in bed because I have no longer the energy to continue. And my enemies will find me sleeping there. Your enemy, God. And he will laugh at my failure. Can you believe that a guy who is said to be after God's own heart is talking to God this way? But he doesn't stop there. And this I love about David, that he allows himself the the emotions to be part of who he is. He recognizes that there's more to him than just flesh and bone. He recognizes that he has culture as he talks about his enemies and those people around him. He recognizes that he has a soul, that he has emotions. He doesn't hide from any of that. Instead, he just pours all of that out, but he doesn't stop there because he recognizes also that he has intellect and he can remember. It says in verse 5, but I trust in your what? Unfailing love. Maybe love is the answer. My heart rejoices in your salvation. I will sing praise, really? For God has been good to me. I mean, this isn't the first time that we've ever heard of singing praises in a time of solace, right? I remember Paul, who said that I delight in my weakness because in my weakness God is made strong. Really? I don't know about you, but when I'm feeling down and out, I don't feel delighted. And another time when Paul was walking with his friends, the other apostles, just having been beat in a prison cell and released, he said that I consider it pure joy for having been persecuted for God. Pure joy? And I've wanted to be in that place. In my times of sorrow, I've wanted to say, God, this is pure joy. Oh, thank you so much. Like, I'm joyful now in the... I mean, she hates me, but isn't that great, right? Like, my finger's still black from dropping a sink on it. Like, oh, isn't that wonderful, God? Like, I want to sing a song to you now. It's the Smash Thumb song. It's this contrast, right? But isn't there poetry in contrast? Isn't that what that light and darkness shadow thing was about when I'm staring up at the mountains? There's that contrast, and sometimes we appreciate more when we've experienced pain. And David doesn't stop with just his emotions. He remembers that he's a whole person, and he continues with his remembrances. He says, I will sing praise to the Lord. I will rejoice in salvation. I will trust in love. How can he do all these things? And he makes it plain at the very last sentence, for he has been good to me. David remembered God's goodness. What does David claim he will do if and when all these things happen? He will rejoice and sing. He will rejoice and sing when the Lord hears him or else does not. He will rejoice and sing when he sees the Lord's face and when he cannot. David will rejoice and sing when he wrestles with his thoughts, when he has sorrow in his heart, when his enemies triumph over him, when there's no light in his eyes, when he cannot sleep, when he feels like he is dead and dying, when his enemy wins, when he falls on his face, when he fails, when everyone laughs. David says he will rejoice and sing. How can he do these things? Because he remembered that God had been good to him. Even when David felt like God was not necessarily good to him in the moment, David remembered when God was good to him. He sang from his heart. He was honest about his feelings. He didn't try to fool God or deny his lament. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? Do you not care that your silence causes me to wrestle with my thoughts? When will the sorrow in my heart matter to you? David didn't run away from such things, but he also remembered the goodness that God had given. So how are you feeling this morning? What's in your heart? It's okay. Whatever that is, it's okay. I encourage you, though, also to remember. Know that it's okay to feel sorrow. Just remember when God was good to you. It's okay to be full of unbridled joy, but remember those who are in pain. It's okay to be poor, but remember God's faithfulness. It's okay to be rich, but remember the poor. It's okay to wrestle with your thoughts, but remember your duties. It's okay to fail. Just remember to get back up. It's okay to play, but remember to work hard. It's okay to laugh and to cry and to be silent and to run and play and blow snot bubbles. For everything, there is a season. It's okay. But remember that God is with you. Maybe you're in a rut today. Maybe you haven't felt joy. I mean, real joy in a long time. Maybe finances have got you feeling like a failure. Maybe you feel ugly and useless or used up. Maybe you talk to yourself the way you would never talk to a friend. Maybe you feel rejected by your kids or abandoned by your parents, misunderstood. Maybe the very person you love seems to hate you. Maybe you feel lost and alone and desperate for something you can't quite put your finger on. You just know that if things continue the way they are, you're not going to make it. And you think and you wonder and you ask, how long will I have to endure this sermon? Kidding. How long, you ask? It's okay. David asked that question too. Friends, I'm not asking you to stop feeling whatever it is you're feeling. I'm not asking emotions that get invoked or triggered by whatever memories are chalked away in your heads. I'm not asking that at all. I believe that God gave you the ability to do that for a reason. But I am asking you to remember as David did, as I am trying to remind myself, when God was good to you. It might not take the difficult feelings away, but it will put a song back in your heart. Maybe your grief keeps you from feeling joy today, but you can remember some joy of yesterday. And I think that's what rejoicing is. If today, Lord, I cannot experience joy because of this thing that's keeping my emotions from letting my heart go that direction, but like David did, I could remember some joy of yesterday. I can remember that time when God was good to me, and I can scoop up that little moment. Like when God spoke through my grandmother, and she used to pull me up into her bosom, this big, mushy bosom, and she had these lips with too much lipstick on, and this mole with the hair growing out of it right here. And my grandmother passed away. She died of breast cancer, of all things, can you imagine? But my memory is in her bosom. And she would pull me tight. And she would tell me ridiculous things. Like, you're so precious, Robbie. You don't know how precious you are. Do you know, Robbie, that I adore you? And I think these things come from God. You are precious. And God adores you. And you were given the ability to find Him and others precious and adoring as well. And we can take those moments and we can lift them up and bring them over into our sorrowful moment where we can't have joy. And we can remember the joy from before and we can rejoice. We can rejoice and sing. Because we remember. Let's pray. God, thank you so much. Thank you so much. It's hard to thank you for times of trial, but when we get through them, Lord, we can look back at them and see how they softened our hearts and caused us to see colors we couldn't before and appreciate love and compassion in a way we couldn't before. And so I thank you. I thank you for my trials. God, help us as we leave here today and we go about our regular duties, our regular life, and as we begin to experience varying emotions, God, help us temper that with the rest of what you've given us, with your Holy Spirit, with our souls, with our intellect and logic. But let us, God, also not dissuade that gift of emotion that you've given us. And let us be honest with this. And help us come to you, Lord, with whatever it is I know that you can handle. Most of all, Lord, we ask that you would help us remember the way that you worked in and through our lives. We love you for it, Jesus, and thank you in that name. Amen.